A draw knife is a very useful tool, particularly for working green wood. Draw knives come in all sorts of different sizes and styles. This is just a quick look at some of the draw knives that I've acquired over the years. Only one of these is one that I've made, and that's this little one that I still haven't put handles on. The rest of these are antique draw knives, or at least used draw knives. Actually, that's not true. I bought this one new, but it was probably about 40 years ago, so it's pretty well used by now. But draw knives are different sizes. They're different shapes, different width blades. Some have a fuller down the middle like this one. Some are extremely small and delicate. Some are meant to be used beveled up. Some are meant to be used beveled down. There's just all sorts of different options with a draw knife. So today I thought we would take a look at what it takes to forge a draw knife. We'll make a very simple draw knife as far as design goes, but we'll complicate it just a little bit by making it out of two pieces. We're going to use a W1 steel edge on a mild steel body. And when we get to the end of the full series of videos on this, I think I will try to explain exactly why I think that makes for a better draw knife. But you can make it out of one piece if you want to. It does decomplicate it, makes it a lot easier for you. So let's head up to the shop and see what goes into making a draw knife. Well, what goes into making a little draw knife? Certainly you could start with something like 1/4 by 1 inch flat stock in W1, 01, 51, 60, some kind of a good medium to high carbon steel that'll take and hold a good edge. And really very simple to forge a draw knife. It's not too hard. You forge a tang on each end and you forge a bevel. But I can't leave it that way. I can't make it that simple. Part of why I'm doing these videos is to help encourage more traditional techniques and to challenge yourself. So we're going to forge weld the cutting edge on. And to do that, I have a piece of 1/4 by 1/2 W1. And I chose W1 because of the hardening and tempering, it's easier to get a draw knife into a larger container of water than for me to buy enough oil to get a container that long of oil. And this piece is 5 inches long. And then I have a piece of 1/2 inch square bar that is 9 inches long. Now, somehow we have to hold the piece of W1 onto the mild steel. Frequently, what I will do is I will tack weld this. Quick, simple, very reliable. In the end product, the little bit of weld is all ground off, goes away, has nothing to do with the finished product. But not everybody has a welder, and it isn't a traditional way. Now, traditionally, it would probably just be very carefully brought out of the forge to the anvil, and it would just sit there. And you'd get your weld, and it'd stay after that once you get the first little forge weld or a tack weld from the forge. But there's always that risk when you come out of the anvil that you're going to bobble it a little bit and drop it on the floor. That gets frustrating, so let's try to avoid that. And this is what I have in mind. Now you want to get this pretty much in the center of your bar. It's much more useful that way and everything stays balanced. And I've ground the back of the W1 and I've beveled off the edges so that I've got a little scarf to weld down, and I've ground this, and that'll help prevent any scale inclusions. Some oxidation will get in there while we heat it. It's just inevitable, but if we start without any, we're better off. I'm going to wrap some baling wire around this. The baling wire won't be part of the finished product. It's just there to hold this in place while we weld. But that will keep that bar intact and on there, and it shouldn't be a problem. I'm going to fold my baling wire back, and I'll start on this end. I'll hold this end and start my weld on this end, and that way all these tails of baling wire are out of the way. But once I get my first weld, all of this can come off. So let's go to the fire and bring that up to welding heat. I'm going to be working in the gas forge this morning. It allows me to get a nice even heat over the whole piece. You can certainly weld in a coal forge, But that means I'm going to be leaving the gas forge running throughout the welding process so it doesn't cool down and have to come up to heat each time. It'll be much more efficient and better for the workpiece. Now, in a coal forge, the heat is hotter at the bottom and the fire is a little cooler at the top. The W1 welds at a lower heat than the mild steel, so you don't want to get it too hot. It also burns easier. So you would put this in a coal fire with the W1 or the tool steel component up. In a gas forge, the opposite is sort of true. It's a pretty even heat, but there's more blast on the top, so it's going to oxidize the tool steel more. So I'm going to heat it with that side down. That's an advantage to the baling wire. I can get away with that. Or if it was welded, if I was just trying to balance it, it would have to go up. A nice initial heat here. And I'm going to go ahead and flux it. I'm using borax as a flux for this first heat. And it may be the only time I use borax. So I want to make sure the flux really gets down in there and borax flows very nicely. Fire to come up to welding heat. I have my fan to make it a little more comfortable in here, but I'm going to turn that off while we weld because I don't want anything taking any heat out of the weld. Quick light blows to get the weld set. Don't hammer on your baling wire. But it now doesn't serve a purpose. I get it off of there. Beginning of a weld. I think I'll go back to the borax and flux this where it's opening one more time. And then push that down so it's right where we want it. Then we're going to progressively weld our way up the bar. Light rapid blows until you got a good weld, and then you can start refining the parts that are already welded a little bit. I'm going to go ahead and turn this around, but I'm not going to start here. I'm going to start where I finished and work out that way. That way all the crud keeps being pushed out the same direction. Flux every heat. Wire brushing and fluxing every other heat works pretty well. Now I don't need the borax so much because there's probably still some of that down in there. Just enough to make sure there's some flux on the edge. That's Iron Mountain flux that I'm using. But Easy Weld or something like that would work. Much everything welded except the very tip of the scarf. Let's catch the scarf using the corner of the peen to make sure it gets worked down in there. That's going to get worked some more, so it's not likely to go away or to be ignored. I'm going to turn it around and try and catch the scarf on the other end. Same thing, a little bit of the peen, and make sure that's worked in. Let's turn the forge off for just a second here. Oh, that's so much quieter. Now, in an ideal world, your forge weld is ultimately going to disappear. But I need to know where it is, so I'm going to put a couple of center punch marks
on the very end of the half inch mild steel. This will eventually be the tang and buried in a handle, so they'll never show. But that way I've got a reference to know what side my tool steel's on. So that's a pretty good weld there. I'm going to try and work the scarves just a little bit more in as we do the next step, just to make sure. Next thing I want to do, though, is make this a half-inch square bar again. And that brings the whole thing into one plane, and it'll all make sense before we're done, I promise. So we're going to heat it back up, and we're going to work it at welding temperature. Even though it's welded, we want to be absolutely sure, and we don't want to risk working it cold and shearing the weld. But mostly what we're doing is drawing it out just enough to make it half-inch square. So it's just a matter of forging it into a square bar. At welding heat, it goes pretty darn quick. Seam pretty much starts to disappear at this point. But because of our punch mark, we know which side it's on. The next thing we want to do is stand our square bar on the diamond with the anvil down here, and our tool steel then, I'm going to need a little bit more soapstone, our tool steel then is on one side of the diamond. And when we are then going to flatten this into a rectangle. So when we flatten this into a rectangle of about 1/4 by 1, we are going to end up with a bar that looks like that with the tool steel right here. And if you don't knock your corners off, that means that this will actually have a little corner with the tool steel protruding to the corner. And that will eventually become your cutting edge. Now we're going to have to work this some to keep the bar in control so that it doesn't work quite that way. It ends up being more of a true rectangle. But in the long run, this is where our bevel will go. We'll forge a bevel in, and that's how the tool steel ends up right where we want it. Hope that makes sense. So let's forge our square bar into a rectangle. And it doesn't matter which way you stand this at this point. It only matters when we have to decide which side of the knife the cutting edge goes on. So it doesn't matter which side's up, we just want to go to a rectangle, and we want to work at welding heat to protect our weld. We also want to keep an eye on our little center punch marks, so we kind of have an idea where they're at. See that one. So before I turn this around, I'm going to put it back in there. It's a little bit deeper so I don't lose it. Thank you.
inch mark on this end. Now we really need to straighten that up. That's not very even, but it's getting close to what we want. The tang will go isn't real critical, but the section that is got the steel where the blade is needs to be good and even. Right now that is 1/4 inch thick and about 7/8 wide. That's not bad. It's going to be a small draw knife. So really, up to this point, all we've done is create the billet of steel that our draw knife will be made out of. Now what we know, I've got a punch mark here, so I know my tool steel is in this area, and ideally I would like to find the edge of my scarf at this point. So I know where to step the tang off. I think I see a little bit right there, so right at that, I'm going to just notch in just far enough that I can find that again, and I think I've got enough heat to do that on the other end. I see just a little bit of a scarf there, and I'm hanging that little bit of unwelded scarf over, and I'll work that some more as I draw out the tang. If it doesn't seal up, it doesn't weld, eventually it'll be ground out. So now I know this is the side that my tool steel is on. And that's the side that will be our cutting edge. So let's draw the tangs out. This does not need to be done at a full welding heat. Actually, if you have a lot of that scarf to weld down, you do need to do this at a welding heat. But there's so little sticking up, I'm not worried about just getting rid of it later. So we want to draw out a nice tang that will eventually become something we mount our handles to. And you want this to be fairly long so you can get the handles out away from the blade. And a nice long taper. So that's a good start. It's probably going to take 3 or 4 heats to get it right. Now let's go to the horn. I know you can't see that as well on the camera, but it will draw out much faster.
So that gets most of the work done. We're going to clean it up on the face of the anvil, then we'll turn it around and go to the other side. I got rid of that glove on my hammer hand. It was being a real nuisance. I do want the tang about the same width as the blade and a little wider than it is thick. Or in other words, the blade's a quarter inch thick, so I want this to be a quarter inch thick and about 3/8 wide, just to have some good support up in here when you're using the draw knife. I'm going to knock the corners off of that just to make it more comfortable to use in the long run. That's really all the forging we need to do to a tang at this point. However, I now start losing my weld seam again. So there's my center punch mark there. I already know it's running down this edge. I just need to remember it's on this face. So I'm going to take my center punch one more time. And down here that will be buried in the handle, I will put another punch mark. That one's not going to go away because I'm not going to do anything heavy to that anymore. So it doesn't have to be a very deep mark. Now I just need to find a pair of tongs that fit that tang. It'll be a little less convenient, but I think that'll work with the tang coming off the side there. Just like the last time, that'll take a couple of heats. The goal here is to make both tangs match. One more heat and we'll be there. Well, it looks like the microphone battery went dead, so we just need to finish drawing out this tang and get it to match the previous tang. It's pretty darn close here. This is a good time to start worrying about keeping things relatively straight in line. Get any little lumps and bumps out as you're drawing it out to make sure it comes out good and even and straight. And you can either use a pair of dividers to check the length and compare it to the first tang, or simply take a measurement. I'm going to use a hook rule here to double check that measurement. I wish I remembered exactly what it was. Ultimately, the tool steel has to be on the flat back of the blade so that when you sharpen the bevel, you always have this much tool steel on the bevel. And as you work that back year after year, and it'll take 50 years of use before you wear out the tool steel, there's always this point right at the cutting edge always has tool steel. So that means it seems logical to take and forge the bevel from this side. Leave this flat on the anvil and forge a bevel. But what happens when we do that? We're starting again with our our rectangle. Tool steel and mild steel behave slightly differently. Mild steel moves easier at heat than tool steel does. Tool steel, because of what it's alloyed with, resists the hammer blow more. Whatever is down on the anvil, down here, cools off faster, and therefore it doesn't move as well. Whatever is on top that is getting the direct blow of the hammer has more effect from the hammer than the piece on the bottom does, the rebound from the anvil. So there are three things that make the tool steel move less and the mild steel move more. So what does that mean for us? That means if we try to forge this bevel, what we're really going to do is push mild steel over the end of this draw knife, and we're going to end up with a mild steel edge out here. And as you sharpen it back, sooner or later you get to the tool steel, and it'll be fine. But for the first year or two, you're going to be sharpening it three or four times a day because there's no tool steel there. That's not the idea. So let's instead put the tool steel up here and forge the bevel on this side and push hopefully some tool steel down here, and then we will turn it over and push the bevel back so that ultimately the tool steel is all, it's hard to draw upside down, hopefully then the tool steel is all there and whatever we've pushed out is tool steel, and we'll have to just move the bevel back over. But drawing out from this side means it stays hotter, gets more effect from the hammer blows. It's still tool steel, so it's still going to resist. So to some extent, we're going to be pulling both of these out together by working the tool steel up. Hope that makes sense. We need to find that punch mark that we had in our tang. And it seems unlikely I would have lost it already. There it is right there. So we know the tool steel is on this side. And I'm just going to start forging that down. Make sure you're not hitting the anvil with your hammer. And that's going to help me see the bevel I'm starting. And I'll be able to find that in the next heat. So that heat's really just a heat to establish what I'm up to. And sometimes you can see a line. I don't think you'll be able to see it in the camera, but I can actually see a wavy line here that represents the edge of the tool steel. Now, as you work the edge, it's going to bow backwards because you're drawing the edge out longer, and this metal's got to go somewhere. So if we put an intentional bend the opposite direction, it'll start to correct itself. And this little double rail track thing works pretty well for that. So let's go back to forging our bevel. Now, something that might help to keep your hammer from hitting the anvil is to have an anvil block and work at the edge of the anvil block. Ultimately, you're going to finish this bevel with a grinder. I'm going to turn this around and work from the other side. Remember, when you turn it around, now you're working the other side. Of course, the tangs don't want to cooperate. They're just hanging out there in space and get all floppy and weird. So I'm just going to keep going until it's about straight again. And then we'll clean that up and push the bevel to the other side. Now remember, you're working a weld here, so try not to work anything too cold. That's looking pretty good. Do a little bit more here, turn it around one more time, and I think we'll be about done. Last flip, and we should be about done with the forging steps here. So now we need to kind of straighten the bevel out because we're still beveled on the wrong side. So to do that, let me get this hot again. I want to locate my punch mark again. Right there. So this is the tool steel side. I'm actually going to bevel up the back from the back about 30 degrees, and I'm going to use the hammer to create a flat back. And that uses the anvil then to create that bevel. And this seems to work better for me than trying to come up here and forge the bevel down this way. But there's some refining and back and forth. And you're doing very little forging here, so start going to lower and lower heats, and that helps refine the grain structure of your material and helps keep the scale off. But like I say, no real forging, you're just straightening and smoothing at this point. Turn this thing back and forth and around so many times it starts to get confusing on which side is tool steel and which isn't, so I have to keep referring back to my little punch mark. So I'm glad we put that in there. In the long run, what matters is the side with the tool steel has to be flat and the bevel has to be on the side without the tool steel. And for now, I'm going to leave the tang straight. It'll eventually get curved, but it's easier to grind if it's straight. Well, how about we put a touch mark in there? So I like to put my touch mark on the bevel side, so it's where it will get less grinding, because only the bevel gets ground, not the flat spot of the bevel side. Hope that makes sense. And it doesn't have to be super hot for a touch mark to show. And that is about that. One last little straightening, I think. And then we will be done forging for now. I'm pretty darn happy with that. So that's what we've got at the moment. I know it's kind of hard to see in a gray draw knife against a gray anvil. Well, that is pretty much all of the forging steps that go into making a little draw knife like this. There'll be a little bit to shape the tangs and bring them down so the handles work like a draw knife. But that's not going to take much, and we'll probably do that with a torch. So I think we're going to call this video good and make it a part one, part two. I thought it might be one just long video, but I think there's enough information here to be just a standalone video. Then we'll pick this back up with part two, and we will look at filing or grinding to shape the blade and get the bevels straight. We will harden it and temper it. We will shape the tangs, or we may shape the tangs first, and I'll talk about some options on why you might do one way and why you might do another way. And then we'll see if we can get it polished up, ready to work. And there may be a third video on making handles, but that's more of a woodworking project than a blacksmithing project. So we'll see if we do that. I do have a wood lathe, and I'll probably do the handles there, but I'm not the best turner, so I don't know if you really want to watch me fumble at the wood lathe, because some of you who do know how to turn wood are probably going to cringe when you see me do it. But we'll see. Maybe I'll go ahead and do it anyways just for laughs. Anyways, that's all I've got for today. It's just a little afternoon. It's coming up to the hottest part of the day. And it is boiling in the shop because I've been running that forge at welding heat most of the morning. And I think that's the last forging I'm going to do this afternoon. We'll be working on some hinges and some other stuff that doesn't require the forge. So it'll stay a little bit cooler in here. Hope you enjoyed it. Give it a thumbs up. Love it if you hit that subscribe button. Stick around. Watch a few of the other videos. Come back. Watch part two. We'll finish the draw knife. But in the meantime, if you can get out to your shop and make something, go do it. Try not to overheat, or try not to freeze if you're in the southern half. Stay hydrated either way. Stay safe. Wear your safety glasses, and we'll see you for the next one.